categories for screen and key. Yeah.
Champagne had never seen anybody vote before. Now think about it.
our form of voting for granted, and yet it wasn't always so. And now I think we're coming into a time, the system we have, first past the post, was designed for two parties. And in this country, for a long time, we had two parties. Yes, occasionally another party would show up. It was truly the Tories and the Grits, the Liberals and the Conservatives. And now we have become a multi-party country. And our voting system does not reflect the multi-party country that we have become. And we talked to a lot of young people on this campaign about why they don't vote. And the thing they say most often is it doesn't count. It doesn't matter. And I think a lot of that is first past the post. I actually believe that if we are successful in this campaign of defeating Stephen Harper and having some form of minority government that includes the Liberals, the New Democrats, and Greens, the next election will be a different one. I truly believe proportional representation will change everything to borrow a line from Naomi Klein. So I'm just very briefly, oh darn, I forgot to turn on my timer, but I'll assume that I've got about 8 or 9 minutes left. I'd like to go back in history to talk about something that in this election campaign has become so contentious, and that is what happens in minority government. Because there's a lot of discussion. If you've been at any of the all candidates meetings, you've heard my colleagues from the New Democrats and now the former colleague from the Liberals say, you must vote for us. Because if we don't have more seats than Stephen Harper, we won't be able to stop him from forming government. But they forget our history. Our history has told us that some of the best governments in Canada have been cooperative governments. The minority governments, the ones I like, I call them the Camelot of Canada, are, 1963 and 1965, some of you have heard me talk about this before, the minority governments of Lester Pearson, hotly contested elections, and the Liberals ended up with 121 seats, and the Conservatives under John Diefenbaker, we're talking strong leaders here, under John Diefenbaker had 97 seats. And the Socreds, that kind of get forgotten in all of this, they had 24 seats. And the NDP were the fourth party with 14 seats, but they were led by Tommy Douglas. Now, that government was not a coalition. It was a government where the parties worked together. And between the minority governments of 63 and 65, we as a country saw ourselves bring in Medicare, interest-free student loans, the Order of Canada, our Canada Pension Plan, and we adopted our flag. The compromise flag, not the Pearson pennant, and not the Union Jack, but the compromise flag, so Canadian. And what I love about the debate over the flag, and I won't walk you all the way through it, was that 40 Conservatives, after a long filibuster, voted with the Liberals. Unheard of! But they were free to do so. They were not a heavily whipped vote in those days. And they were free to do so, and they did. In fact, two Conservatives from Quebec went to Pearson and said, invoke closure. Pearson will, or Diefenbaker will talk forever, and you'll never get this flag in, and it is time. And if you bring in closure, we'll vote with you. And we ended up with our flag. And I think if you look back at what was accomplished, as Elizabeth likes to say, you can all accomplish a lot as long as you don't care who gets the credit. And right now, I think an awful lot of parties are worried about who's going to get the credit. You know, we need to get the credit for being the party that does something about climate change. We need to get the credit for being the party that does something about addressing inequality. And that is paralyzing us. You know, I also did a little bit of history about minority governments that we've known more recently. And I'm sure that my friends in the New Democratic Party do not want to be reminded of the time they voted with the Conservatives in 2005 to defeat a Liberal government because they thought they could go to the polls and win a majority. Because what happened was we didn't get a majority. It was just in the middle, actually, of Montgomery and Quine. in 2005, November 28th. And it was the New Democrats who voted with the Conservatives to defeat the Liberals. We didn't require an election until 2009, but cooperation was being thrown out the window. I would say in favor of thinking they're vulnerable, let's take them now. So what did we end up with in 2006? Our January 23rd election, I went to the polls in the middle of winter, a Stephen Harper minority. Stephen Harper never really thought he should rule, you know, he should have government as a minority. He had 124 seats, the Liberals had 103, the Bloc had 51, and the NDP had 29. We did pass a law with that minority government fixing election dates. But constitutionally, you can't make that stick. So in 2008, when there'd been a fair bit of talk about coalition between the Bloc and the Liberals and the NDP, Stephen Harper thought, we can't have that kind of talk going on. And the Liberals were busy shooting each other in the foot. So he thought, I might as well get them while they're weakened enough with that fixed election date. Let's go to the polls. So we have the 2008 election where Harper dissolves Parliament because he feels he's losing motions of confidence and might be forced to go to an election. He wants to be in control. And of course, that's how we ended up with the 2011 majority. So in this election campaign, when I hear Liberals and New Democrats talk with great fear about minority government, I think, really? You know what possibility exists, but you also know what it takes to make minority government work. It takes a dedication to putting aside at times the party's needs, the party's agenda, and working on a Canadian agenda. And I think it is important that we're talking about democracy in this election campaign. Democracy is very important. We talk about what is common in our platforms, and because we've had so many debates, of the nine debates that we've had, the Conservative, John Mazzutti, has been at one. And that was the one today with the Chamber of Commerce. And I must admit, I've met Mr. Mazzutti, he is a fine man, but I question his interpretation of democracy. In my opinion, coming forward to meet people in a forum with your fellow candidates is essential. You do not earn votes if you're not willing, even though it can be uncomfortable, I'm sure, to be a Conservative these days in Victoria. And so I have great sympathy for him. But he knows that the record of his government is what he at least has to be able to acknowledge. But more importantly, he has to tell people what he plans to do for the future. I mean, he does say he's knocking on doors, and all of us are. It is important to meet your constituents. But in the end, we have met thousands of people at these all-candidate forums. And by not coming and not being willing to earn people's votes, I feel he has shown disrespect for democracy. And democracy. I know that when it comes to talking about power and concentration of power and how what that has done to democracy, Elizabeth is the expert. She's been living it. But I will say one thing that I noticed when I was in the media, and this will be my final point. I noticed that we had an awful lot of politicians who, when they were willing to talk to us, and certainly you all know how many politicians in the government benches we were unable to talk to, but when they were willing to talk to us, it was usually because they had an eye to re-election. And I do think that because the parties have had such strict control of their MPs, and MPs, while they do, they're allowed to voice their opinions in caucus in private, but are told then how they must vote, they have too much time on their hands between elections. If you're not reading every piece of legislation, if you're not out doing research and talking to people who can make sure you're well informed on a piece of legislation, then what do you have to do as an MP? Your job is to get re-elected 4 years later. So you spend a lot of time doing good things, you know, going to public events, talking to the media when it suits your purposes. But your job then becomes getting reelected. And then do you know what happens? You start to think about policy in four-year cycles. And one of the things I also think is broken in democracy is we have stopped seeing leaders who are willing to look beyond the four-year cycle. We're willing to say, where's the big vision? Here's our vision going forward. You know, Margaret McMillan last night spoke on risk-taking. And I think sometimes politicians today, while it is very risky to go into politics, and I admire anyone who does it, not for the faint of heart, let's put it that way. But we need to risk thinking big ideas. You know, when Tommy Douglas introduced Medicare into Saskatchewan, before it was federal, all of the doctors went on strike. And I mean, we don't mean back to work legislation. We mean on strike. No doctors in Saskatchewan to deliver babies or aid the dying. They had to bring in doctors from Britain. And I can imagine the pressure on Premier Tommy Douglas to abandon his Medicare. Instead, he met with doctors over a two-week period, and they hammered out a compromise, and they went back to work. That's vision. That's risk-taking. That's a politician who sees the future and is prepared under our democratic system to move forward and take that risk for the good of the country. And I hope that that's what we will see in our government after October 19. I know I chose to work with the Green Party because I saw it in our leader, I saw it in our policy, and I have seen it in almost every person I've met and been in contact with in this party. Thank you very much.
Very grateful to all of you. one I was supposed to cover with the question, why Parliament is broken? Which we could also ask, some of you may have seen my last book, Who We Are, where I describe the state of Canadian democracy with reference to the Monty Python skit. I don't know how many of you are Monty Python fans, but you may remember the dead parrot. It's not dead, it's merely nailed to a silver perch. Oh, it's not dead, it's in your belly, it's nailed to a silver perch. It's a dead parrot. Well, democracy is very nearly the dead parrot. One of my favorite journalists, Jim Travers, who was the editor and publisher of the Ottawa Citizen for many years, very revered journalist, print journalist in Canada. And when my second to last book came out, called Losing Confidence, and we were both on Sunday edition with Mike Lenreich, it was a really telling moment because Joanne knows how CBC does things, right? So Mike Lenreich, of course, had to go first to Jim Travers. Well, no, that's not right, I got it wrong. He went first to me, and he said, Elizabeth, your book title is Losing Confidence, the Crisis in Canadian Democracy. Tell us why you think it's a crisis. So I went through the reasons. Falling voter turnout, abuse of power by the Prime Minister's office, slavish following of whip votes and leaders telling MPs what to do and when to do it, and a loss of parliamentary function. I described it as it stood when my book came out, which was 2009. And then Michael Enright turned to Jim Travers and said, well, Jim, is she exaggerating? Is there a crisis in Canadian democracy? And Jim Travers said, oh, I think she's really understating it. He said, if you go to Ottawa these days, what you'll find is basically a democracy theme park. All the buildings are there. You can go visit them. You can take a tour of Parliament, but you won't find democracy. That was pretty hard-hitting. And things got worse between when I wrote that book, Losing Confidence, and when I wrote Who We Are that came out last year. How did they get worse, and what's the source of the problem? For this, I turned to a renowned academic and expert in Canadian democracy and our parliamentary institutions. He's Professor Emeritus from the University of Toronto, and his name is Peter Russell. And what he has said in his book, which, by the way, if you want to read up on this stuff, Peter Russell's little tiny volume, it's great. It's called Two Cheers for Minority Government. It's something every Canadian should read between now and October 19th. But anyway, Peter Russell said, the threat to Canadian democracy is an increasingly well-funded and powerful political parties. That's why I call a speaking tour I did during our second prorogation. I did a cross-country speaking tour with the subtitle, Rescuing Democracy from Politics. The threat to democracy comes directly from well-organized, well-financed political parties. So, let's go back to square one. What's in our Constitution? What does Westminster parliamentary democracy look like? Under our Constitution, all members of Parliament are equal. And the only job description of a member of Parliament in any legislation is what you find in our Constitution, which says members of Parliament represent their constituencies. That's all it says. Why doesn't it say members of Parliament must obey every whim of increasingly whimsical, unpredictable, reckless federal party leaders? They must do what they're told. The reason there's no such reference in the Constitution is that political parties aren't mentioned at all. So certainly leaders of political parties are not mentioned in our Constitution. How did we get to this place? Well, in the early days, political parties didn't have any real sway in Parliament. One of my favorite quotes from our first Prime Minister, Sir John A. Macdonald, is he referred to the members of his own party who served with him in Parliament as, quote unquote, loose fish. They weren't swimming where he wanted them to go, and they sure weren't nailed down. Now, in this context, it's not a dead parrot nailed to its little perch. It's a fish, good and nailed down and not going anywhere. There are no loose fish around, not in the NDP, the Conservatives, or the Liberal Party, anyway. So how did democracy get so challenged by the growth of political parties? They put their own organizing, which are basically not laws, right? They're organized as separate societies, right? Just the way any organization of the Societies Act is organized. So the decision of how does the leader of a party get elected, well, that is also not a law of Canada. That's the law of the Conservative Party, the internal laws of the NDP, the internal laws of the Green Party. So as the parties got more and more power, which they started doing first in 1963, bigger parties always make good laws for themselves. It's a trend. In 1963, they decided all of us bigger parties should get more money from the public purse because it's so hard staying on top of all the issues. So big parties, over 12 MPs, should automatically get money from the public for running our operations on Parliament Hill. And then on top of that, over time, with no rules changing, they decided to say, and by the way, if you don't have 12 MPs, this is just by tradition and practice, no rules are changing. If you don't have 12 MPs, you can't sit on committees, and you have no automatic right to speak in question period. Strange, because all MPs are still equal. The next big change was 1970. Up until 1970, the ballot, when you went to vote, showed the names of the candidates, but didn't mention their political party affiliation. Well, that was a big change in 1970. Put the name of the political party next to the name of the candidate. And then they decided, well, we better know that this candidate really is approved by this party. So how do we do that? They decided, we'll get the leader of the party to sign the nomination papers for every candidate, then we'll be sure. They weren't, I really do think that this is under the law of unintended consequences, that they created a huge stick with which a leader of a party can both threaten and punish an MP who doesn't do what they're told. Because sadly, the leader of a party, for the first time, had a plausible threat to use. If you don't do what I say, I won't sign your nomination papers. I'll throw you out of caucus. I'll throw you into oblivion politically, and you will never recover. Well, there are also other punishments that leaders of parties use, but that's the big stick. Since that time, we've seen a steady growth in the power of political parties. But we've also seen a steady growth in the power of something else. Something else not mentioned in our Constitution. The Prime Minister's Office. The PMO is all it's called these days, and everyone knows what it means. And you would swear, if you landed on Canada from another planet, you'd think, oh, this PMO thing must be exactly like the White House is in the United States. It's a very, very powerful agency. It's not mentioned in the Constitution because it shouldn't exist at all. And up until Pierre Trudeau, it didn't exist. Lester B. Pearson, we've talked about Lester B. Pearson's wonderful minority parliament and the cooperation with Tommy Douglas and Lester B. Pearson. Lester B. Pearson's office was described by his principal secretary as a handful of file clerks and stenographers. It was not what it is today, a $10 million a year operation of extremely effective spin doctors and enforcers. So how does this threaten democracy? What's changed? There's been a steady trend since 1970 that every prime minister who takes office looks at the powers left behind by the previous prime minister, consolidates them, and expands them. Rather than go into the details, very prejudicial, let's just say what happened in 2006 under Stephen Harper. And I'll quibble only slightly with Joanne's historical review. When the NDP, the Conservatives, and the Bloc Québécois brought down the Paul Martin government on November 28, 2005, the NDP did not have in their sights winning government. They merely had in their sights destroying the Liberal Party, so that eventually, after a couple of elections, they might win government. So that was one of the turning points for me in deciding to get involved in partisan politics. But what's happened under Stephen Harper with the majority has been truly shocking. The thing that holds Westminster parliamentary democracy together, since it's not constitutionally enshrined, that a prime minister's office has this kind of power, but the parliament has that kind of power. We're not, in other words, living under a constitution like that in the United States, which was written by a bunch of people who, let's face it, didn't like arbitrary abuse of power. They got mad south of the border at King George III. They thought, guys off his head, and we don't accept taxation without representation. Our side of the border, we thought, guys off his head, the next game won't be so bad. So we didn't have a revolution here. We continued to abide by the fundamental principles of Westminster parliamentary democracy. It means we're vulnerable to someone who's ruthless. We have a system of government without checks and balances and no protections against the ruthless. Why did Paul Martin, knowing that the execution date for his government loomed before him, his executioners announced their plan in advance? The Conservatives, the NDP, and the Bloc said very publicly about 2 weeks before, some of you will remember this, it's funny how quickly we forget things, but I remember it really clearly because November 28, 2005 was the opening day of the climate negotiations in Montreal, and I was absorbed, obsessed, and working on climate. So the idea that the government fight might fall, the opening day of the negotiations, had me, to put it mildly, freaked out. So they announced it ahead of time. We are going to bring down your government, Mr. Martin, on November 28, 2005, unless, some of you may remember the condition, unless you agree yourself to bring down your own government in January. Why didn't Paul Martin prorogue? Close down the House of Commons. He knew he had a vote he was going to lose. Going to lose that vote for sure. The answer is it simply would never have occurred to him because it simply wasn't done. Was it legal for Stephen Harper to shut down Parliament because he saw a vote he was going to lose in the fall of 2008? Sure, it was legal. Nobody had imagined passing a law to make it illegal, because it was something no one would have ever imagined a prime minister would do. When I was researching my book, Losing Confidence, I looked in Commonwealth countries all around the world to see, did any Westminster parliamentary democracy, how many times has a prime minister shut down Parliament to avoid a vote they knew they were going to lose, and where has it happened in other Westminster parliamentary, in the Commonwealth, a fairly large chunk of countries? Turned out the only time it had happened before was in Canada, under Sir Johnny MacDonald, in the Pacific scandal. And when the House resumed after prorogation, he immediately resigned and the country went to an election. Yeah, I did find one example of a prime minister in Sri Lanka went to the governor general to get the House shut down to avoid a vote he was going to lose, and the governor general said no. Prorogation is an enormous abuse of power. And we've had it happen, well, it's happened 3 times under Stephen Harper, but 2 of those times have been illegitimate. What's happened with whipped votes? Well, I worked for a period of time in the 1980s in the Office of the Minister of Environment in the Mulroney years. I wasn't a Mulroney fan. At the time, I kept thinking we should be doing so much more for the environment. In hindsight, it's become a sort of environmental Valhalla of achievement, but at the time, I was frustrated. But we had very few whipped votes. We did a lot of cross-party cooperation. As a matter of fact, I was in charge of the negotiations to create Guayaquil National Park. And every few days, my boss, Tom McMillan, would turn to me and say, Elizabeth, what does Jim Fulton think? Jim Fulton, I hope a lot of you remember Jim. He was the Member of Parliament for the NDP for Skeena Buckley Valley and the NDP Environment Committee. And Tom would say, does Jim know what we're doing? Does he approve of this plan? Does he think it'll work? Does he have to call him? It's okay. And he'd say to me, have you called Charles Katchum? Charles Katchum is the Liberal Party. Is he okay with what we're doing? And Tom would say, have you talked to Buddy Richardson, Council of Haida Nation? Does he think we're okay? It was very collaborative, very open. We wanted to make it work, so we worked it together. That doesn't happen anymore. And as far as whipped votes, they're every single vote is whipped. Closure. Joanne mentioned using closure on the flag. You know how rare it was to invoke closure? I went and looked when I first got elected. In the first 7 months that I was in Parliament, there were 40 moves to close down debate. So I went back and looked, and I found that over a period of, wait, no, I got that wrong. The first 7 months I was in Parliament, I went back and looked because we had had 14 prorogations of that. And I found that over a period of 45 years, there had been 7. By the time we adjourned in June, closure of debate had been used 100 times. Almost every debate on every bill had closure. I thought things couldn't get much worse. Then they have whipped votes in parliamentary committees, which used to be extremely nonpartisan. Whipped votes in parliamentary committees is at a refusal to accept amendments to bills. On a bill like Bill C-38, which was 440 pages long, the omnibus budget bill that destroyed the Fisheries Act, the Environmental Assessment Act, you probably remember it. But from first reading to royal assent, the Conservatives did not accept a single amendment, even to correct drafting errors. Every amendment became a political war that Stephen Harper refused to lose. Lastly, during this election campaign, we came, things can't go. Forgot to mention before I get to lastly, something else that no prime minister had ever dared to do. Gag the scientists, shut down the research, fire Statistics Canada, get rid of the long-form census. I heard the other day from someone, and I believe this to be true, although he told me as a senior federal civil servant about to retire, he said, you'll never find a piece of paper that says this, you'll never find an email that says this. But when Stephen Harper got rid of the long-form census, Statistics Canada civil servants were told, the job of Statistics Canada is to make sure there are no statistics that contradict government policy. I believe it. So they reached across the divide between the Prime Minister's political office and the Civil Service Privy Council office, a wall that's not supposed to be breached, to demand that the civil service produce the evidence they want by cooking the books. The last thing, this came out after the writ dropped, and I find it so shocking, I can't believe how our news media doesn't cover this. Elizabeth Thompson from iPolitics did the research. She went through, believe it or not, 22,000 orders in council. An order in council is a record of a cabinet-level decision. She started noticing an anomaly. All orders in council are listed on the government website. And even if the text of the order in council isn't included, if it's suppressed as secret, there's a note. This one isn't being published for such and such reason. And maybe she was looking at Order Council 334 and then realized the next one was 336 and thought, I wonder if there was a 335 or if they skipped a number or what's going on. To make a long story short, her research confirms that under Stephen Harper, there have been an alarming number of decisions that bind the government of Canada with no record kept where the public can find the existence of the decision, much less its content. This is particularly chilling when you realize one of the things I think they did where the order in council is hidden is taking land out of Cape Breton Highlands National Park to give it to a Toronto businessman to build a monstrous statue to honor Warden. Taking land out of a national park, not publicly released. Worse, I think this is another hidden one, is a treaty with Ukraine. I've been trying to get a copy of it. I didn't access the information request. I had a leak from someone within government that Canada had actually executed a treaty with another sovereign state that Canadian parliamentarians weren't supposed to know about. It's not one of the ones that's listed. It doesn't take much to get Canada bound by a treaty through the most arbitrary means, because guess what? Treaty powers exist in Canada under royal prerogative. So the Prime Minister with Privy Council, without the use of Parliament or a vote, can exercise royal prerogative. That's how they ratified the Canada-China Investment Treaty. Royal prerogative. And we happen to know that now the ordering council doesn't even have to represent a decision or a vote by cabinet. According to Elizabeth Thompson, they just walk the piece of paper around, and when four ministers have signed it, Bob's your uncle. You've ratified a treaty. Now, the fact is right now, which is egregious, despite the fact that they are only, in theory, a caretaker government, they are actively negotiating the Trans-Pacific Partnership as we speak. They can't ratify it during the election. I don't think they dare. But they can conclude the negotiations. And then we'll find out if the Trans-Pacific Partnership coming back to Parliament can be stopped. We need real democracy in Canada. The only party that understands all these multiple threats and understands we have to take the Prime Minister's office apart brick by brick is the Green Party. We want to cut the Prime Minister's office. We have to cut the PMO budget at least in half. I see that as a good start. We have to now pass legislation that says you can't erode without a three-quarters vote in the House of Commons. You can't shut down science. You can't fire scientists. You can't suppress scientific information. Every MP has to be free to vote in the interest of their constituents. No more.
In which things going well is good news.
Peter Victor, by the way, is speaking, I think it's tonight in Vancouver, who is a York University economics professor, who wrote a book called Managing Without Growth by Disaster or Design. The timing of the publication of this book was completely unexpected for him and made his book quite a sensation. It came out within weeks of the 2008 financial disaster. So what I want to say about tweaking the numbers or manipulating the numbers, there's no question that Stephen Harper's administration has created a false, fake surplus for last year. They have definitely played around with government spending and done things that actually increased the risk of a recession. They announced a few weeks ago in the midst of the election that we now had, oh surprise, last year, ending in the spring of 2015, it wasn't. We weren't in deficit after all, because there was $8.7 billion that wasn't spent. Look, Kevin Page is no fool, our former parliamentary budget officer, and he said, which was obvious, obviously what happened is Stephen Harper told his departments, certain departments, not all, to put the brakes on spending. So this is money that was budgeted that was supposed to be spent. $8.7 billion is a lot of money not to spend. Where did they decide to put on the brakes? Well, that's right. First Nations communities were one place that lost money that was supposed to be spent in the budget. Municipal infrastructure, public transit, another place where they put on the brakes. Another place, processing refugee claims. Another place, Veterans Affairs. So they created a fake surplus last year. This year they created a fake surplus by postponing our budget till April 21st so they could book the sale of the GM shares into 2015-2016. So it's a lot of fakery going on there. In terms of recession or not recession, the reality is our economy's been stagnant for the last 3 years. So while we talk about a steady state economy, it doesn't look like a stagnant economy the last 3 years, because in a healthy steady state economy, you move to full employment. So things are humming along as opposed to petering out. You need to have a very different kind of economy to meet Peter Victor's standards of managing without growth. So the reality of it is, they may or may not have filled those numbers. I tend to think they didn't, because they'd be caught out very quickly by the people they worry about, the money guys. They don't worry about fisheries biologists. They worry about the money guys and the banks saying, wait a minute, we think, because they've got their own independent money and their own independent numbers. Chances are we're still in, marginally, a recession. The funniest part, I shouldn't go on with this, but the funniest part is listening to Stephen Harper say, well, it's only the energy sector that's in decline. These other sectors, manufacturing, pulp and paper, tourism, oh, they're doing better. Those are the very sectors Stephen Harper has ignored for 9 years while he put all of his economic development plans in the oil sands. So that's a too long answer, Joanne.
Well, just one thing on stats, Canberra, because you asked, and that is, you know, the long-form census was replaced with a national household survey. And it cost $22 million to put out that survey. And you need a 75% return rate for it to be statistically significant. We only reached 69%. So in order to save all that money by not having a long-form census, we spent $22 million for useless information.
Thank you. We're going to go to a question, I believe there's someone in the back who had their hand up. Okay, we'll just go to you,
thank you.
Sir.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Rory Delaney. Elizabeth, I agree with everything you said. And I've watched you fight to have a say in the Parliament of Atlanta. You know, which is terrible. But we the people, we all of us stood by for 10 years and watched all this happen. What can we do? What can you do to stop us from being so complacent?
Rory, thank you. Actually, I can't bring it. It's not in my heart to blame Canadians for this. In short, I blame the Canadian media. our journalistic core has ignored this as it happened. I've gone into editorial board meetings, a number of them, where I talk about what's happening to Canadian democracy, and I've had journalists, really respected journalists, names you would know, say, do you think Canadians care about this stuff? That's exactly what they say word for word, and in that tone of voice, in different operations. Do you think Canadians care? Well, they would if you told them. If it was news coverage, they said, well, Privy Council Office, having the Prime Minister breach the firewall of the Privy Council Office, orders of council that are secret, you think Canadians care about this? Yes. Do I think they care about democracy? Yes, I think we care about democracy. So one piece of a healthy democracy that we're missing right now is competition and diversified ownership in our news media. We have 42 daily newspapers owned by Post Media. Now it's true, the Globe and Mail is no longer has any ownership interests from CTV, but the Globe and Mail is owned by a corporation, but there are very few independent voices anymore within the news media. And so I think that's a big part of the problem. What we can do, and you're gonna have to see, you gotta follow up, but what we can do as citizens is share this information as much as possible, is write letters to the editor. I want to know of all the candidates in this election. I want to know from the leaders in this election. What will they do to restore parliamentary democracy and reduce the power of the Prime Minister's office? I think it's a key question to push Tom Mulcair on and to push Justin Trudeau. We know where Stephen Harper is on it. But I had hoped, I should mention this now so I don't forget later, one of the, we talked about the debates and not having the conservative local candidates show up. It's essential that we somehow convince, although we just heard yesterday that he won't change his mind, we convince Tom Mulcair to show up, because the national televised leaders' debates broadcast by CBC, CTV, and Global are probably 24 hours away from being canceled, because neither Stephen Harper nor Tom Mulcair will come. And that's a really key opportunity to engage Canadians across the country in what it means to have a healthy democracy where parliamentarians respect our traditions and recognize the fundamental principle of supremacy of parliament, that the Prime Minister reports to parliament and not the other way around. The way it's going now, the Prime Minister's office is controlling absolutely every decision by the bureaucracy and by the politics and by the governance structures of our country. The only thing Stephen Harper hasn't managed to wreck yet is the Supreme Court of Canada, but he's working on it.
Thank you. My fear is that Stephen Harper has shown how it's done. And
yes.
Let me think, there are lots of people who would love to duplicate what he's done.
Right. I was just going to add briefly to what Elizabeth said, but you're absolutely right. Stephen Harper, for example, is the person who said, I'm not going to a debate. And then Tom Mulcair said, well, if he's not going, I'm not going. And, I've got to give credit to the woman who walked into our office the other day. She said, I've never voted green before. I'm voting green because Tom Mulcair won't go to the debate and there have to be consequences. And you know, what can Canadians do? There have to be. Was our national broadcaster. And I know I have a vested interest in this, but I have worked in public broadcasting and private broadcasting pretty much all of my life. And I can tell you, and my colleagues in private radio, television, and print will tell you the same thing. If the national broadcaster is setting the bar here, the privates have to set the bar here. When the national broadcaster brings the bar down here, that's exactly what happens with everyone else. You've heard the stories of how hard it is in this media environment to make money. You don't spend money on your newsroom if you don't have to. That has always been the case. And we have one CBC reporter for all of Vancouver Island. One. Now you tell me that that's putting pressure on other newsrooms around this province. It's not. And there's a real, I know that Stephen Harper ideologically doesn't like a public broadcaster, but he has destroyed it for a very specific purpose.
Yes.
Good evening. My name is Greg Meeklejohn.
System, I would like to ask you what your plans might be
For those, what, one in every 10, one in every 5 Canadians has some form of disability? What, do you ever hear anybody on the podium say, this is what we're going to do for the disabled? No. I want some form of constructive approach to even identifying them in Canada, never mind helping them. For example, how many people in this group could live on, what, $1,000 a month check and have to pay $800 a month rent? I think I made my point. You can fill it all in. As I said, Reverend Chizik in, what was it, 07, called me the disability advocate. I worked for 20 years with a partial, if there's such thing as a partial disability, of an audio disability, which I have. I became involved with the disabled, and I have done nothing. I'm lucky because I had made enough money while working to pay for my place. I can hardly afford to live on what I'm receiving now. I mean, I'll probably get cut off from disability by even saying this. I'm just, in a way, playing the worst possible scene. Of course, be prepared for the worst and hope for the best. I hope for the best from the Green Party to help consolidate and appreciate or support us disabled who can't work. Thank you.
And I can tell you that I'm really pleased to be able to tell you that it's in our policies and our platform to bring in a Disabilities Act, something that Rick Hansen has been advocating for a long time, that protects the rights of the disabled population of Canada to work in the way people want to work, to have dignity and a decent wage and if you're not able to work, and to have the programs and supports that the disabled community needs. Now, one of the things we'll do, which will be helpful to everybody across Canada, two key things that also particularly assist the disabled. One is guaranteed livable income to eliminate poverty. Another is our housing policy to improve access to social housing, as well as more affordable housing for people who are in the marketplace looking for housing. Another is pharmacare, to reduce so that no Canadian goes without a prescription medication. So taking those pieces together, now in the short term we'll increase the disability payments within the current scheme because no one can live on the amounts that are there. It will take a couple of years to get us to guaranteed livable income, and I know there's a lot of people lying at the microphone, but I want to just explain how we get there from here. We believe we need to change the way we make decisions in Canada without opening up the Constitution, but it's been pretty much frozen in place since 1867, how we make decisions. We want to create a Council of Canadian Governments, with the federal government, provincial territorial governments, representation from municipal board of governments, some big city mayors, a few rural mayors, as well as First Nations, Métis, and Inuit, all sitting around the same table to solve all of our problems. Poverty is a problem. It needs to be solved. We can solve it. To make it pay for itself to eliminate poverty, you need municipal order of government, you need provinces, you need the federal government, you need First Nations governments. There'll be band-aid programs that don't help anyone get out of poverty, but cost a lot of money to administer, that we can wrap up and end and replace with a check to every single Canadian to ensure that no one lives below the poverty line. That's a very straightforward plan. It will save the Canadian economy enormously, but it takes a couple of years to put in place, which is why we will increase income supplements now, increase guaranteed income supplements for seniors, increase support payments for disabled Canadians, and also pass this Disability Act to make sure the right to work and the right to dignity and key rights are protected in law.
Another answer to Greg Beaglejohn's question as well. This Prime Minister has chosen not to meet with premiers. And that conversation has been broken and not happening for 9 years. By putting a Council of Canadian Governments in place, Prime Ministers in the future will have a permanent forum that will allow this to happen when they can't decide it. They just don't want to talk to you.
I'm just going to interrupt. questions we're going to be able to get to this evening. If we will end at 8:30 just because we want to respect everyone's time, but if we don't get to your question tonight, we will find answers for you. We'll get you your answers afterwards. Go ahead.
My daughter just gave me the handsome. Mommy, shorter answers.
Good evening, my name is Natasha. Now, I've heard this answer before, but I'd love to hear it expand upon by all of you. How is voting green not splitting the vote in Canada?
Okay, our problem in Canada, really quickly, isn't vote splitting. As a matter of fact, if there had been no Greens on the ballots at all in 2011, it wouldn't have affected the result at all, except that Gary Lund would still be the member of parliament for international violence. The reality is that the big challenge in Canada is vote abandoning, yes, not vote splitting. The largest voting bloc in Canada the last few elections, 40% of Canadian voters, they're people who stay home. So there's what my daughter calls some truthiness around this idea. You think, well, there's people and there's... The reality of Greens is we increase voter turnout on Vancouver Island. In particular, nobody should be worried about vote splitting, because what's the notion here? We've got no chance of a Conservative winning in Victoria, and we're still told we might split the vote. In Saanich Gulf Islands, I get people saying to me, I voted for you last time, I think you're great, but this time I really have to stop Stephen Harper, so I have to vote strategically. I'm afraid that the messaging around vote splitting, as well-intentioned as it will be, I say, I love people in many of the groups that are trying to make people worry. Fear not, I say this in the church, fear not, on Vancouver Island, there is not a snowball's chance in hell of a Conservative winning in Victoria, or, you know, these ridings are not about to vote for Stephen Harper. The reality is, we will grow the vote, help us grow the vote. Find people who didn't vote in 2011. We know that Stephen Harper has made it harder for people to vote under the Fair Elections Act. Find people who didn't vote last time. Take them early. As a matter of fact, go to the returning office now, before the Thanksgiving weekend when the advance polls start, where there's more time to go in and make sure you've got all the right paperwork. Rose Henry's organizing for homeless people. We need to help people who have a right to vote get out and vote. That's much more important than making people fearful, afraid to know how to vote, maybe not turning out to vote because they're so sure that voting for what they want will somehow turn into something bad. Voting for Joanne Roberts will elect Joanne Roberts.
Well, it gets me out of bed every morning. I mean, how could I say I'm tired when
when I know that there are going to be hundreds of people that night working on my behalf. So yes, Nancy's right. I know now what I didn't know before. I know what wins elections. Elections are won by talking to people one at a time. You have to knock on every door. The ones you think are going to throw something at you say, "Oh, I'm so glad you're here. I'd like to vote green." And you kind of go, "Really? That wasn't what I expected." And then there are the people who say, "Well, I didn't know if I was going to vote, but you came to my door. So I think I will." Like, it's that simple. So if you want to help on a campaign, come on out. There's nothing like it. It is the most, if you believe in democracy, that the speech I gave in the beginning comes strictly from watching democracy in action every day, in our lives, on doorsteps, being at things like this, talking to your friends, making sure that everyone you know votes.
I just have to say, if you believe in fun, if you want to make wonderful friends,
yes.
If you want to be able to say to people, "Boy, between October 1st and October 19th, I had the fun of my life and the best party afterwards, and I want to tell those stories to all my friends." A lot of you in this room, I know you all, the ones that were Saanich 12 Islands volunteers who got me elected. How many of you volunteered in SGI in 2011? A lot of you in this room, right? This, and didn't we have fun? And are we having fun getting to us?
Unilaterally. The king had
That's where the House of Commons comes from. We are the commoners. Joe Clark said Stephen Harper is violating Magna Carta. I've never heard a stronger indictment ever, and we need to respect those basic principles that there is no such thing as unilateral power in a democracy. It doesn't vest itself in the monarch, and it sure as hell does not vest itself in the prime minister.
We're already going to push this beyond the time, so I do want us to hear your questions, so if you can see me after, then we'll make sure I can connect you with Joanne or Elizabeth, so go ahead.
My name is Tom. I'd like to know what alternatives to First Past the Post you're proposing, and if you think instituting mandatory voting would be beneficial or detrimental.
Thank you, Tom. I'm sorry. The reason I feel so guilty because I gave too long answers. Okay, first of all, we want any form of proportional representation. The Green Party supports getting rid of First Past the Post because it's a perverse voting system. But we're not rigid on whether it's single transferable vote, mixed member proportional, or some other system. Personally, I think we should consult and have a referendum across Canada, but I wouldn't quibble if a prime minister wanted to say if it was Tom Mulcair or Justin Trudeau, we've decided we want to put this to a vote in Parliament right now. It only takes a bill in Parliament to change our voting system. We don't have to open up the Constitution. It can be done very effectively. My personal preference, to give you the full answer, is I prefer mixed member proportional because you have a link to your local MP and your Parliament as a whole reflects the way the public actually voted. And I don't particularly like mandatory voting, although it's better than nothing as a solution. And one last thought about the voting system. The Green Party would like to lower the voting age to 16 to be sure that we see higher voter turnout by getting young people voting when they're in a context with a high school, they can study the platforms and start getting used to the process of voting. Although I think with mixed member proportional, more people are going to vote anyway. So thank you for a great question and thanks for a great town hall. And I, for those of you who are still alive, I will definitely talk to you as soon as it's over.
And I'll wait.
So very quickly before we finish up for the night, I'd like to invite Sonia Thoreau, my colleague and co-campaign manager, and Joanne up.
I know this, I'm not supposed to talk to you. I just wanted to say how grateful I am to all of you. I didn't sufficiently say how much it will mean in the House of Commons to know that when the Speaker of the House says, the honorable member for Victoria, it's going to be Joanne Roberts sitting next to me, who's standing up. We're going to make it happen. And nothing would give me greater pleasure than to be there to support this amazing woman and free her to do so many things.
Like
lead climate change in Paris. Sarah Potts, where's our volunteer? There she is.
Kendall still here? Yeah, come
Murray.
On up.
Murray's
Murray Denison, come on up, Murray. Where's Olvis? Oh, you're here.
Bob Warwick, because Olvis already holding on the table.
Bob's already working. So, have we got anyone? We've got tons of canvassers, button makers. Yes, there you go. Come on up, Bob. There's Karen. Now you know you want to work with this great bunch of people. Oh, Janet, what are you doing still sitting down there? Janet, she was our office manager. She doesn't know I have work to do. This is Janet from our office tour today. And really, these are the people with titles. There's lots and lots of wonderful people who are working in our office. And I know every one of them would love to have you come and join them. Sonia's going to tell you how you can do that, but I just want to say, I can't imagine working with a more dedicated and more inspiring group of people. Every day I come into the office, and somebody's got something great to say, and it doesn't matter how long the day was the day before. I come in and someone says, the coffee's on, and gee, you did a great job last night. Hey, what do you got on today? And you know what? The spring in my step keeps me going.
It'll be a close campaign, we know that for sure. And as Joanne said, campaigns are won when you get out on the doorstep and out at events and out on the street corners at rush hour like we did today, and you just connect with people. You tend to see the campaign from the air. You see the media, you see news reels, but that's not where campaigns are really, really happening. That's not where they're won. Certainly not where Green Party campaigns are won. Green Party campaigns are grassroots campaigns. In other words, you people are the secret sauce. So now I have a challenge for anybody who's already campaigning, and that is this. Can we barricade the doors, please? The challenge is this. Find one person in this room before you leave who's willing to come talk to Sarah or Janet or anybody at any of these tables, any of us, and talk about how you can get involved. We have 19 days. 19 days. I would like to find 7,000 more supporters in those days. So if we have 500 people looking for 7,000 supporters, that's pretty doable. How many is that? Anybody do math literally? Was that 35 votes each?
14 people.
Yeah, it's totally doable. Anyway, so I invite you to join the campaign if you haven't ever done so before. You build community in a way that you've never done before, and it's a life-changing experience. With that, I will also invite you for pancakes. Which makes perfect sense. Saturday. So talk to us today, but also come see us Saturday morning, 9 o'clock. We're going to make pancakes. We're going to make pancakes, and we're going to talk to you about what campaigning looks like, and then we're going to go do some campaigning. So you're all welcome to come do that with us at the office, 843 4th Street. So you've got two options. Talk with us today. Actually, you don't have an option. You have to talk to us today. But also, you can come see us on Saturday morning. Thank you. Hi, Nancy. Thank you very much for coming.
Don't forget the
Oh, the rally, absolutely. We're gonna have so much fun this week. We're busy. We also have a rally at Ubik tomorrow, Town Hall at 1 o'clock in the quad if you're a student or if you're on campus. Okay. With that, I want to thank everybody that's here. Stefan, do you get thanked enough? Oh. He's funny, right? This woman, when I sat down to talk with her in January, to say, okay, if I'm going to do this again, because I had just finished the campaign, if I'm going to do this again, tell me why you're doing this. And for 2 hours, she spoke my mind. For 2 hours, the passion to change what was wrong in this country blew my mind, and it convinced me to just toss my life and my 12-year-old aside for 9 months. It's okay, no, it's okay. So that I could elect her. Come help us out and find the links so you can make all the difference. Thank you, Joanne, for being my inspiration. And Elizabeth for being all of our inspirations.
Joanne and many other Green candidates elected in 18 days.
Yeah. Yeah.